In this problem, we're computing the arc length of this curve y equals square root x on the interval 0 to 4. And we're asked to do this by integrating with respect to y. So before I write down the arc length formula, I just wanted to note here that at the end of this interval, that's x equals 4. That corresponds to y equals 2. So when we integrate with respect to y, we're going to use the interval 0 to 2. So just a real quick rehashing of the arc length formula. The arc can be broken down into infinitesimal contributions that we refer to as ds's. Each of those ds's can be broken down into horizontal and vertical contributions. Those we call dx and dy. And all I do is apply the Pythagorean theorem, and I find that ds squared is equal to dx squared plus dy squared. And this means our expression for ds is the square root of dx squared plus dy squared. Then typically what we do is divide a dx squared out of that square root and write it out to the right. And that would leave us with a dy dx squared in the interior. That's the derivative of y with respect to x. And the differential outside of that would be a dx. But this time we're integrating with respect to y. So we're going to factor out a dy squared from the interior of the square root, giving us a dy outside the square root. And again, we divided that out of each term. So I end up with a dx dy, the derivative of x with respect to y squared plus 1 inside that square root. And to get that derivative, I have to express x as a function of y in my original formula. And all I have to do is square both sides to get that done. So x is equal to y squared. And the derivative of x with respect to y is simply 2y. And if I square that just to prepare to plug into the formula, I get 4y squared. So this means ds is going to be the square root of dx dy all squared. So that's 4y squared plus 1 dy. And with ds phrased entirely in terms of one variable, we're ready to sum the arc length contributions. This is what integration does. It adds up a bunch of infinitesimal, continuously changing contributions. So I sum all the ds's, and my y limits of integration are 0 to 2. So in principle, we're done with the problem, but things are going to get hairy really fast here. So this is definitely a trig sub integral. I have something squared plus 1. And if I could replace that something squared with a tangent squared, that interior would reduce to the secant squared. Then when I square root it, it becomes the secant function. So my trig substitution is to let 2y equal tangent theta. And that guarantees that 4y squared will be tangent squared theta. And I have to transform the differential as well. So I differentiate both sides, multiply by d theta on both sides, and I get 2dy is equal to secant squared theta d theta. In other words, dy can be replaced with a 1/2 secant squared theta, d theta. I'm also going to transform the limits of integration here. So this is a y limit of y equals 0 all the way up to a y limit of y equals 2. So when I sub in y equals 0, that would give me 0 equals tangent theta, so theta is equal to 0. That's easy enough. When I sub in y equals 2, I would get a 4 equals tangent theta. And we're not talking about a special angle here. I just have to write that theta is the angle whose tangent is 4, the inverse tangent of 4. So now our entire integral has been transformed in terms of theta. I have the integral from 0 to inverse tangent of 4. And then inside my square root, 4y squared is just tangent squared. So I have a tangent squared theta plus 1. And then the differential dy transforms to 1/2 secant squared theta times d theta. I'm going to move the 1/2 out in front. Then in my square root, 1 plus tangent squared is secant squared. But when I square root that, I get the secant function. So that secant multiplied by the secant squared that's already there gives me a notorious integral, this integral of secant cubed theta d theta. So let's bounce to another page real quick. And the integral of secant cubed theta is an entire video in its own right. And I made a video for this, and I'll post a link to it real quick. It actually requires using integration by parts with the looping trick for integration by parts, if you're familiar with that. The way it turns out is 1/2 secant theta tangent theta plus a 1/2 natural log absolute value secant theta plus tangent theta plus a c, of course. So we apply our secant cubed formula to this integral, and I end up with a 1/2 secant theta tangent theta plus 1/2 natural log absolute value secant theta plus tangent theta. And then the whole thing is evaluated from 0 to the inverse tangent of 4. So we'll pull out the 1/2 from the interior there, so we get a 1/4 out in front. And then we end up with a bunch of trig functions of inverse trig functions. And the way that we handle these is by using a reference triangle so we can visualize the angle that we're talking about. So in this upper limit, I'm going to sub in the angle whose tangent is 4. So for example, I need the secant of the angle whose tangent is 4. And we'll make a picture for that. Before I move to that step though, I want to evaluate the lower limit and just convince you that that vanishes. So if I sub in 0 for theta, the tangent of 0 is 0, so the first term is gone. What about the natural log term? If I sub in 0 for theta, the tangent term is gone, so I'm not worried about that. And then the secant of 0 is 1 over the cosine of 0, which is 1, and the natural log of 1 is 0, so that term vanishes as well. So all I'm concerned with here is subbing in the upper limit, and I get the secant of the angle whose tangent is 4. Multiplying the tangent of the angle whose tangent is 4, well, that's just 4. Plus a 1/2 natural log of the absolute value of the secant of the angle whose tangent is 4, plus again the tangent of the angle whose tangent is 4, and that's just 4. So secant of the inverse tangent of 4, that's what we need our triangle for. So the angle we're talking about is the inverse tangent of 4, the angle whose tangent is 4. So there's theta, its tangent is 4. So I can write the opposite side as 4, the adjacent side is 1. Which means, using the Pythagorean theorem, that the hypotenuse has a length of square root 17. And the secant of that angle is the hypotenuse over the adjacent, which is just root 17. So my answer continues to simplify, and I have 1/4 times 4 root 17. And I just realized when I factored out that 1/2, I forgot to remove it from the natural log term, so I'm just gonna kill that real quick. And then I have a natural log, absolute value again, secant of the angle whose tangent is 4, which turns out to be root 17, and then plus 4. And maybe it's nicest to go ahead and distribute the 1/4 back into this thing. And I get an exact arc length of root 17 plus 1/4 natural log. I don't need the absolute value signs anymore because I can see this argument is positive. So 1/4 natural log 4 plus root 17. And we're done. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.